I was relieved when they played me Bye Bye Baby, because I figured that, oh yes, I could see that. So I kind of breathed a sigh of relief. Hang on a minute, that's a hit record. There were hundreds and hundreds of kids outside through the night, outside the studio. It was great. I'd never seen anything like it. You told her that I can't ring her. There's a wedding on my finger. She's got me, but I like me so.
Remember most is getting out of the bus, Birmingham City Centre, running down New Street towards Birmingham Odeon and seeing a very thin line of police who were trying to barricade it off. And as we were running towards them, seeing this fear on the face of the policeman. It was my only experience in my early teens of being in a huge crowd of girls my age and feeling that kind of power. In running down the middle of the street, for instance, not the pavements, but the middle of the street, it was fantastic. I remember screaming my head off. I remember the girl next to me screaming so much she wet herself. And I remember afterwards just feeling like I was drunk and singing all the songs on the way home and stuff.
It was just amazing. Like, to be at the end, at the receiving end of that noise and that reaction was just something that it only happens. I mean, you're lucky if it ever happens to you.
As soon as we walked up on stage, they screamed. I remember thinking, oh, what's happening here?
and they used to throw stuff. You used to get the camera and the flash cube. You used to go black eye. You used to get your eye almost taken out of these cubes and stuff.
How can this be happening? You know, I don't know these people, but they know me.
Bye Bye Baby was the sound of the summer of 75. You just couldn't escape it. Radio 1 chart DJ Johnny Walker found it all too much.
I introduced it in a way that really wasn't, you know, I didn't slag them off, but I just said, no, number one again is the Pacey Rollers, you know. And about 5 minutes later, phone goes, duty officer on the line, you know, hey, having a lot of calls, Johnny. Pacey Rollers fans, very angry indeed, you know. Record ends, open the mic. That's apparently upset the Bay City Rollers fans by not being reverential enough at introducing their record. I said, well, you can just stuff it, you know. I said, don't expect me to like their music, because I don't. You can like it, fine. I said, but I think it's musical garbage.
People said totally heinous things like, you know, they can't play their instruments, or their songs aren't very good, or they're not even that good looking. I mean, you know, now you look it back and think, well, they're quite innocuous, sensible things to say, really. But at the time, we thought, you know, these people must die.
It's all over the papers, you know, Walker slams Rollers, musical garbage, all of this business. Get a load of hate mail started coming in.
If people talked out against the Rollers, you know, we'd write angry letters. We were really pleased if they had to backtrack.
Really colourful stuff, the sort of thing you get from fans, you know, great big crayon stuff and lots of red and Walker, you should die, you know, and all this, a lot of hate coming at me, really.
But the teenage love affair with the band grew and grew. At a Radio 1 roadshow, DJ John Peel filmed the extraordinary effects of Roller Mania.
The Bay City Rollers were being helicoptered onto this small island one at a time. Now, the only security that was available were, for reasons which I've never known, but I don't want to know, really, it's just the whole thing was just so wonderful, were members of the BBC Subaqua Club. So you've got these, mainly very, very short and rather stubby, like, so it's like tree trunks dressed up in tartan, but they're coming across the grass and they start wading through this weed-filled water, which is disgusting. And these people, the subaqua people, are sort of standing there in their rubber outfits and with flippers and stuff like this, catching these strange children and carrying them back and sort of dumping them on the other side of the bank or pushing them back into the water. And the helicopters coming over and basing a lot of car noise and screaming. While all of this was going on, Tony Blackburn was speeding backwards and forwards on the lagoon in a speedboat driven by a womble. And I just thought, if I live to be 200 years old, I'm never going to experience anything like this again in my life.
Something always happened, you know, you just thought, this is great. For every good thing, something else happened, something bad.
At the peak of Roller Mania in Britain, disaster struck.
Les had his car crash. I was in London. I remember him phoning me and asking what he should do, you know. It did, at that time, it actually freaked me out, the fact that a lady had died in the accident, in a smash he was involved in, and I thought the image was well and truly battered at that stage.
The concert in Colston Hall, Bristol tonight has had to be cancelled. Les McKeown has been involved in an accident. I understand that the accident took place just now.
I felt really isolated and alone at that point, and didn't really have anybody to help me go through that process.
Les McKeown, the group's 19-year-old lead singer, has been involved in an accident. The accident... Now, wait a minute. It's not as bad as all that.
Quite a severe, horrible thing had happened to me, and there was nobody saying, oh, well, I think you should get some kind of counselling, or let's go and see a specialist or a doctor or something. Or it was just like, he'll be OK. That's Les, you know. He'll get through.
Tabloid attention focused increasingly on the Rollers. The pressures of pop stardom were taking their toll on the young band.
I think Eric Faulkner started taking drugs very innocently. He had a weight problem, and so he started taking amphetamines. But at the same time, when you take speed, it repays you with exhaustion. It disrupts your sleep pattern, and that's what happened to Eric.
But just to get some kip, I just took too many downers. You know, I didn't leave a note, I can't stand this anymore. But that just me having to deal with my own situation suddenly became this story. Yeah, I was just some guy who took too many uppers and took too many downers.
I thought it was really kind of cruel the way that Tom Payton turned that around to and used it as a bit of hype for the Bay City Rollers, to tell you the truth.
And I've told whether it's true or not. It's, that before he called the ambulance, he phoned the Daily Record or the Scottish Daily Express or something, and I don't know. Hey, ask him. Why don't you ask him? I don't know.
No, I think I phoned the ambulance first. I definitely phoned the ambulance first. But he wasn't dying. I mean, he had taken them over. He was drowsy. And I didn't know what he had taken.
This is where we started to fall out with Tam in a big way, because then you got stories like, oh, that got some headlines, like Eric's overdose got something. It was like Alan stuck his head in the gas oven. I mean, well, no way. I mean, Alan drowns himself in beer, perhaps, in the bath. I'd believe that one.
There wasn't even a cry for help. I was drunk that night. I got pie-eyed. I just felt so depressed. I said, what am I doing? How can I not just be myself? How can I not just be a plumber again and walk out in the morning, go down for a pint, come home?
Of course, we've got headlines in these days, and every time one of these stories came out, I thought, we're getting some street credibility. And that's what I was looking for at that time, street credibility.
Despite their troubles at home, the Bay City Rollers set out to conquer the world with the support of a major American record label.
I did experience the phenomena of the appeal of the Bay City Rollers, and it was very infectious, and it was very compelling, and I thought I'd give it a try in America.
Heard of like Slade had come back defeated, you know, and Deep Purple flopped, you know, and everybody was flopping in America, and it was all this thing about if you go to America and you don't make it, you'll never be accepted back in England. We'll all just, you know, you'll be out of our life and that'll be it. And that's what happened to a lot of groups.
I wish we'd understood the power we had then, because on one satellite cast and one TV show in America, it went on the back of that. That was the whole push behind it getting to number one.
January 1976, Saturday Night reached number one in the USA singles chart.
It was the record of Saturday Night that did it for them, and it was just such an anthem, and it became such a big hit on its own. It was purely and simply a hit record.
Do you love me?
Like I love you.
Like I love you.
Or is this goodbye? Or is
this goodbye? Goodbye.
Oh, shoot.
Under pressure from their American record company, the Rollers spent more and more time abroad. It cost them many of their British fans.
And I think it is the classic teen band thing, that it's very difficult to keep your home audience once you start playing overseas and trying to become popular there.
We did have this kind of schizoid career. There was this British thing that was just slowly fading away, but this huge upsurge everywhere else in the world. But we were just selling millions of albums.
Their popularity worldwide